For the Isaacs, music is their DNA. As individual musicians, siblings Ben, Becky, and Sonia, and the family's musical matriarch, Lily, have written number one country hits, produced award-winning bluegrass records, and recorded with legends from every genre imaginable. But it is singing together that has marked their spot in gospel music history. Pairing their astute musicianship with an aw-shucks, down-home demeanor has placed the family band on platforms from the Grand Ole Opry all the way to Carnegie Hall, and now the many times award-winning outfit is looking to the future by celebrating pieces of its past with Favorites, Revisited by Request, a brand new recording that reinterprets some of the group's most poignant and recognized songs. I sat down with the Isaacs at their studio in Music City, USA to talk about the movement of music and their own stories of heartache and healing. This is CCM Magazine's Features on Film, and I'm your host, Andrew Greer. Okay, when I think about this record, and when I think about the unique nature of re-recording Favorites, you know, it'd be easy to do a greatest hits compilation, something like that, but you literally have compiled some of your favorites or fan favorites most requested and recorded them from scratch. What's the genesis of that? Why? You know, what motivated doing it in that way?
You just, as we've been singing these songs, these same songs for 20, 25 years, a lot of them. And as you sing them over time, they change, you know, the way you say a line or a sentence, or, you know, you may hit a note here that you didn't originally do, or take a breath here, and you just get more comfortable with the song, and you just really embrace it more. And so we thought, we've changed so much. We were young when these original recordings came out. I mean, we're talking 25 years ago, and so we were half our ages, just about. And so, you know, our voices have changed since then. So there are a lot of things that cause us to want to re-record them, and also we recorded it in 432 also. So that's kind of why.
Explain 432.
Oh,
yeah. Briefly.
Okay, so the last album before the Favorites one is called Nature's Symphony in 432, and we recorded it in a tuning that's different than the most common international standard concert tuning, which is 440, and that just means that your A string is tuned to 440 hertz, which in any tuner will naturally or automatically be set to tune to 440. But before World War II, there was another more common tuning, and it was nature's tuning. Before tuners were invented, before electricity and all that stuff came around, people would tune to the sounds of nature, just to the human voice. And so a lot of scientific experiments have been done, and it turns out that 432 is nature's frequency, and so we tuned to 432, and you know what? God created everything. He spoke into existence. He spoke everything. So everything that's living has a vibration, and so what is that? What is it in ourselves that really connects with God and heals us in the sound? So,
but for the last 2 years, 3 years now, we do our live concerts all in 432 tuning. So this album just made sense. Favorites, so we just doing
it. Isaacs is the voice of God.
Wow. I hope we can. Wow.
What you're talking about is music literally being embedded within us, which I think...
Frequencies.
Yes. Yeah. It's as if the earth is already singing.
Yeah.
And
yes,
we're just tapping into it, right? Do you feel like that music for you guys, and I know this is probably like, of course, but... how has music transformed you, literally from the inside out?
I feel like, you know, music has influenced good and bad in our lives. I mean, you can take a kid that all he listens to is dark, negative music, and that's pretty much their personality or their view on life. And you can take someone that listens to all uplifting, encouraging music all the time, and that's pretty much their outlook on life. And I feel like music shapes our personalities and our attitudes and our relationships and everything. It's such a powerful thing. And so I guess, you know, for us, of course, being it our job too, and it's very important to us what we sing in and what, you know, what songs we sing, what lyrics we sing, and what message we deliver, and all the way around.
There were a lot of studies in World War II, like with Hitler, where they would play a sub, a low-end sub, and it would cause the people to feel out of kilter or uneasy. And right before he would speak, they would turn that off, and there would be a calming effect.
Like a pink noise or a tuning noise.
And so it was
manipulating
people's emotions and the way they feel. And so, well, you know, when you're in the mall, if you smell a store that smells really good, you're compelled to walk in it or walk away from it quickly. And or loud music. When you're in a store and it's so loud you can't think, you compulsively buy. You purchase fast. And that's a lot of studies that have been done. You know, even commercials on your TV get louder than the shows. And so we're very, very much influenced by those kinds of sounds and noises. And so this record, really the 432 record, especially the Nature Symphony, the frequency of that was really meant for someone to go outside and get reconnected with nature. It's a calming, it's a deeper,
slower,
a deeper sound, but it causes you to relax a little bit more. And so I even got a phone call from a friend of ours the other day who was, she just said, I just want you to know I've been craving listening to that record because of the way it calms me. Mm-hmm. And so the music is very effective to the DNA and to the body and to the soul and to the mind.
So we basically decided that everything we do, including favorites, mm-hmm. we're just going to do mm-hmm. it in 432 right. tuning because it is healing mm-hmm. to the soul, mind, body even, proven. But I had something to say about mm-hmm. your question there because when we're up on a stage or on a pulpit somewhere and you're singing, people sometimes come out to a concert because they want someplace to go and they think it's going to be a lot of fun. And my favorite thing is to see when we'll have a spiritual moment and, you know, it's always expected, but like unexpected. And you see these people that are, you can almost see someone's countenance change when something's wrong. And like, you always see, like, the man will reach over and touch his wife on the hand or close your eyes and you're feeling something. I love that mm-hmm. about the kind of music that we get to do mm-hmm. because I think it makes a difference. It's not just a happy song, which is that's fine, too.
It's not just an escape. There's, like, a purpose
a
to
purpose.
The...
Absolutely. There's a motivation a purpose. To it. Yeah. Right. And I love that part of music because when I go to a concert and I listen to someone, I don't only listen to the singing, but I listen to the stories and I watch. I mean, you get interacting, you feel like you know these people, and something they say or do changes my life. So I think that's neat about gospel music.
Mm-hmm. There's a track on the Favorites record, the Star Spangled Banner, which of course y'all have become, your rendition of the Star Spangled Banner has become so familiar and desired, you know, I think by a lot of people and earned y'all a platform in different ways through patriotic music. I'm curious. I have to ask this all the time, and I think about it. We're in an interesting time in 2018 as disciples of Christ, and I think also as Americans. Mm-hmm. I think that's an interesting, we've always tied together faith in God and government, kind of. Where do you find yourself in that spectrum? Like, what is it to be both patriotic, you know,
I can answer that, and not to put words in mom's mouth, but, you know, we are, our grandparents survived the Holocaust. So it was Americans and our allies that saved my grandparents. So for us to be a part of America, when we stand up and sing the national anthem, it's deeper than just words for us, you know, because our parents, our grandparents, this country welcomed them. Now, it was, you know, they had to go through the right things to do it. You know, my grandparents had to have a sponsor in the United States before they could even come over, which fortunately they did. And mom... Mom moved over from Germany when she was two at 9 years old, became an American citizen. And, you know, it's to hear our grandparents talk about the life from war to America. Mm-hmm. When they got to America, it was a redo for them. So I think that's deeper. It's deeper for us than just words.
Yeah, music is literally your history.
Yeah.
And I feel like being a Christian means you act like Christ. And whether it's you're talking about politics or the grass outside or, you know, something else, you should behave like a Christian. I think the problem for me is that Christian people aren't acting like Christians when they get their opinions and feelings involved and they're mindsets, because politics has a way of dividing us instead of uniting us, which Christ wants us to be united. And I don't care if you're a Republican or a Democrat, I love you in the Lord. And it's okay to agree to disagree. And that's the problem. We're not agreeing to disagree. We're just disagreeing. And everyone's showing their unchristian-like colors. And so we try to be careful not to, you know, I mean, we're all very opinionated. We were all brought up pretty conservative. Uh-huh. So we try to respect our audience, because we do have a variety of, you know, mm-hmm. opinions in the audience.
Any
and
audience,
so
right?
Yeah, it's not our desire to offend anyone with our beliefs. We've been asked to do the national anthem for President Trump at a rally, and we did it because we're singing about America. And we honor our flag, we honor our country. That's the reason why we do it.
But we would do it for any president, yeah. Democrat or Republican.
Yeah. And
that's the thing.
We've been
saying,
criticized for doing that.
Yeah.
That's, you know, it's just like, really?
I said to them the other day, we sung the national anthem at the Brooklyn Nets game versus, who was the team that they were playing?
Cleveland?
Something like that. And so the point is that we didn't get hate mail from Cleveland fans because we sang the national anthem at a ball game.
Sure.
We didn't get hate mail from the Nets because, you know, the people
even
get,
though it was their stadium.
Even though it was their stadium. You see what I'm saying? We sing the national anthem at the Braves game or whatever game it is that we're doing. But only in politics, if you sing the national anthem, are every side offended because you sung it for the wrong side. And so, you know,
I'm singing it for your flag and country.
I'm singing it for the people, not for the political position. And so I will proudly sing the national anthem anywhere God opens the door for us to do it. And, you know, it may hurt people because with that kind of view, but by saying no to one is dividing.
Sure.
And people see it as saying yes is dividing, but the truth is if you say no about singing the national anthem, that's dividing.
Yeah.
So, you know, if we could think more with our heart instead of our emotions and looking at it from different sides. But we're very proud to be an American, and it doesn't, I mean, I'm as proud for the Democrat to be an American as I am the Independent, as I am the Republican, so, or whatever the case is.
That's a unique perspective for our culture and time. And I think it brings it back to, as Christians, we serve, we live, we interact under the umbrella of a big kingdom, right? Kingdom.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
Which then I think allows us, what you're talking about, to serve mm-hmm. our kingdom here and now in a way that can be pure and true and honest and proudly, you know?
And the rockets regular, the bombs bursting.
So I think about your story, Lillian, and I know you've told it many times, but I still love to hear it. And I think especially in the culture we're in, where we don't know where we are all the time, about our country. Tell me about your history coming from a post-World War II, you know?
Well, my parents, as Ben said, are Polish Jewish Holocaust survivors, and they're from the Warsaw area. I believe you were there just recently.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't know each other at the time, but they both had large families, parents and sisters and brothers. And then when the war broke out, of course, the Nazis invaded everywhere in Europe, including Warsaw. And my parents were taken to the labor camp. They went to the Warsaw ghetto first, and they probably spent a year there. And they lost, my mother never saw her brother, sister, her mother again. The same with my father. Once they were separated in their hometown and taken away, they never saw many of their family members ever again. And then they were transported by train to Germany. And my mother wound up in Bergen-Belsen concentration camp. My father wound up in Buchenwald. And they lived to tell the story when they were liberated in 1945. You and I were talking earlier. Mom has said this, and she even articulated this to my children, because when they came in, our blessed American soldiers, and I am a big fan of our veterans, and I'm proud to be an American. I am proud to be an American. And I'll stand up for the flag, and I'll put my hand over my heart, because, as Ben said, America gave us a chance to make a life. I'm living the American dream right now. The soldiers came in and released the people that were imprisoned in the camps. My mother would say, they said you're free, but what does free mean when you don't have any place to go and your family's gone? Where do you go? What do you do? So there were millions of people that were like, okay, what do we do?
Directionless.
What does that mean?
Yeah.
And you know, people don't think about it. They think, oh yeah, yay, but where do you go?
No home to go.
No home to go to.
No food.
No, no family. No, you're just
there.
No place
there. To sleep.
But you're just free.
Go. Right. But then
which is like slavery in some ways.
In a way, but they set up these, like Red Cross, United Jewish Appeal, B'nai B'rith, a lot of organizations came into Europe and set up these places where people would go nursed to health. And then they would, I don't know how they did it because they didn't have internet then and ways to reach out, but they found families and tried to unite them. But that's where my parents stayed in Germany. They got married, stayed in Germany a couple of years, and I was born there. And then we came to America when I was two, and I grew up
through
in the Bronx.
Ellis Island.
Through Ellis Island. But anyway, I mean, you know,
and
I was,
found the Lord.
I found the Lord.
Jewish
in America.
Heritage, right?
But, Jewish heritage. Yeah, grew up in Judaism. I met my ex-husband. We've been divorced for a long time now, but he was a musician from Kentucky, whose father was a Pentecostal preacher, the baby of 17 children. And in the late 60s, I was a folk singer. And I had an album out on Columbia Records. So I was singing in Greenwich Village at a little coffee house called Gertie's Folk City. And there were two acts. Every 6 weeks they changed. So my friend and I were one act, Lillian Marie, and there was another act there from Kentucky. Their name were the Greenbrier Boys. And Joe Isaacs was the banjo player for that band. And he was a cowboy and a handsome, young, charismatic Kentucky boy. I never met anybody like that before in my life. And, you know, I was this Jewish kid from the Bronx that had never met anybody like that. And we started dating. 2 years later, we got married. And we'd talk a little bit about his upbringing. But he was an unsaved believer. Does that make sense? I mean, he was raised that way, but he never really made the commitment for himself to be a Christian. And so we just got married and didn't even dress it anymore. My parents thought I was going to proselyte him to Judaism. That's what their hope was. Because I had
his
a little problem.
His name was Isaac.
Yeah, his name was Isaac. I had the name
exactly
for it.
So it's
a very Jewish name.
When being handed.
For two months, we dated. I didn't know he wasn't Jewish. But anyway, long story short, fast forward, because of a death in the family, he had a brother got killed in a car accident, 27 years old. Because of that death, we went to church one night together as a family with his family. And something happened to me that night. And I didn't know it. I got down on my knees. I'd never prayed that way before in my life. Never knew what, I didn't know what to say. But my heart was breaking. I felt like there was a void. And I saw these people feeling, I mean, there was so much love and compassion and togetherness and community. And I never had that. So I felt this lonely draw. And I got down on my knees. I didn't know what to say. I cried. But then I noticed on the other end of the other pew that my husband was there praying too. And that was the beginning. But I'd never read the New Testament. I didn't know that Jesus was a Jew like me. I didn't know any of that. But it was the beginning of a new life. And for 2 years, you know, my parents found out about my conversion, my completion. And they told me to never come home again. Yeah, I might as well have been dead to them because I hurt them because I became a Christian. And that was painful. But then that all changed when I had my first child. When Ben was born, they had to see their first grandchild. So things got a little better. So anyway, but that's kind of the story. And then we had these three amazing kids, and God gave me
a perfect
trio.
Two of us.
Two of us
are
amazing.
Yeah, two of us are amazing.
So when I think about story, I
did
mean,
you notice the baby was quiet?
Yes.
The favorite child.
Because nobody ever listens to the baby.
I'm the baby of three, trust me. There's a deeper connection. There's a deeper connection, isn't there? Yeah. You just, and you observe everything. Aww. Everyone's like, why really? Do you have so much insight? It's really? Because.
In, that's uh-huh. what it is. Insight.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a certain brilliance to the
I
third,
see your
yeah.
mouth moving, but all I hear is blah, blah, blah.
Insight because you never get a chance to say it out loud because no one will let you talk.
I know. It's true. Yeah. See, yeah. I loved
thought,
it. When my
sorry. What were you going to say? Yeah. Is this your interview or what?
I don't know. But when we think about story, I kind of want to go down the line here because you're talking about singing songs you've sung now for 15, 20, you know, a couple decades plus, and all the life that's been lived in between, that changes. That also changes the timbre of a song. Mm-hmm. So I think about, like, you know, when I first met you, you were pregnant with your first child, and now have a household full of children.
Three
but that
now,
yeah. yeah, but that wasn't always...
Busful.
Yes, that's right. A team full. That wasn't always the case for you, you know, and that's been a journey that's not been easy.
Right, and so what you're saying is exactly true. I mean, when we wrote a song like From the Depths of My Heart, which was our first number one song in 1993.
25 years ago.
1993, our first number one song in the gospel chart. Ben and I wrote that song. We actually had moved from Ohio down to East Tennessee, and we wrote that song in the car on one of the last trips taking stuff to Tennessee. And I was heartbroken. I was leaving my home, and I just graduated high school the day before that. And, you know, and so we were all feeling a lot of emotions moving away. And so that's why we wrote From the Depths of My Heart. And that was what I thought was the hardest time of my life until I went through a divorce, until I, in 2014, lost a baby. I was 6 months along. So now when I sing From the Depths of My Heart, I don't think about moving from Ohio. I think about my little girl in heaven, and I think about how the Lord always heals us and helps us. And, you know, we have to keep trusting Him because we don't know what tomorrow holds. And, but these songs are so, they're so healing, and they fit so many different situations in life. And that's why we keep singing them. Because that's why I think the people keep loving and requesting them, because the, every day a song might hit you in a different way.
Mm-hmm. So that's a different thing.
Becky says, "What my sisters wrote a majority of these songs, actually, and a lot that the Isaacs sing, along with other artists. But Becky oftentimes have said, when you hear a song that we've written, you know what we were going through that day. You know, they have a great way of taking something that is detrimental to us, but writing it in words into music that help people through anything. You know, just they're very good at it. And
oh,
some
he
of
listens
the,
to me.
Oh my Lord!
Just kidding.
I think, was there a song for you, Becky? I'm going to let you talk now. Because I feel your pain. Was there a song that was either born out of or that you guys sing that was specific to your journey, which some people know with this kind of chronic pain and associated with the disease you had? That
on the latest record?
Yeah.
Yeah. It was a journey from pain to praise for me as well, because I was diagnosed with a very rare and severe form of Crohn's disease. And the doctors had said that I would probably go blind in both of my eyes and that I wouldn't live to be an old person. I didn't only have a digestive inflammatory, all of my large bowel, small bowel, ulcerated colitis, all of that was going on with my digestive tract. But I had a skin disorder, which you could never see anything. My skin was normal, but as soon as water touched it, my skin, I would burn. It felt like I was on fire.
She would get out of the shower crying at hotels and, like, rubbing her legs, and she would have to put
we'd have
pants
to
on.
Her.
She would lie on the bed, and I would take a hair dryer and just hold it on her legs because it was the only little bit of relief.
Yeah. And about 30 to 40 minutes after each shower, I would function normal, but... and then I also had I had every kind of itis you could have in the eye, uveitis, scleritis, which basically means the whole eye is inflamed. And they would be as red as, you know, a red hot candy and painful. And, you know, when you're in that kind of pain, and it was just a chronic pain for me for about 12 years. And I was on 20 different medications, countersetting that. And then
anxiety.
Yeah, it caused anxiety
sure.
and severe just panic attacks because I was... always looking for an exit sign or a bathroom. I, you know, and all the while I'm traveling 100,000 miles.
Right.
That's just in a bus. It doesn't include air travel. And people would see me get on stage. They would think, oh, she's kind of shy or stuck up. But I really was just.
And she is.
I'm not. I am shy.
And
I am shy.
Up.
But it, a lot of it was just.
Yeah, pain.
Yeah, coping. Just coping. And then as soon as the concert was over, I have to go straight to the bus and go to bed. But I found a holistic place on February 22nd of 2011 that changed my life. And I began a detoxification process of ridding my body of bacteria, parasite, virus, things that don't belong in the system. And once I began to deal with the root problems, my body started going into 100% remission. And so this year I celebrated 7 years of being 100% free of everything the doctor said would probably be impossible. And so getting back to this latest record, we were in a church in the year of 2003, I believe. And I was in the middle of singing a song called Stand Still, which is on the latest record. And it's just, and a gentleman, an older man, interrupted the whole service and began to prophesy over me. And he said that the Lord was going to give me a testimony that would go all around the world. And it would be like scales that would fall from my eyes, and I would see clearly into the past and into the future, and that my healing was coming. And so a month later,
were
singing.
Like,
well, I was just like, yes, thank you, Jesus. I'm Pentecostal, so I'm like, ooh, yes, thank you, Jesus.
Oh, okay, so this is
yeah, so this is great. And so the next month, we're singing in Ohio, and I was packing up my guitar. And at the end of the concert, some little old lady came up to me and word for word said the exact same thing. This man said in Kentucky, not knowing each other, not hearing each other's prophetic word. And so in the past, 7 years, I've seen that come to pass. And I've seen people from all across the country get help at this clinic that I've went to. But besides that, I've stood still and I've watched God move. And the song that was on the that was prophesied during all this time is now on this record, and so I'm getting to sing that song again with knowing that his word is true. If it's of him, it will come to pass. And sometimes we have to be still and let God do what he's got to do and take that time. And so that's my story, and I'm sticking to
it. And there's people's stories I think about. Some might even die in this body, this context, standing still, you know? It may be a wait till the very end. There's a line you sang on this new record. Now it's a hymn, but you say, "I love to follow Jesus."
Oh, it's not this, this the land
this
of Beulah.
Yes. Oh. And when you sang that in that line, I think, yeah.
Hmm.
You know.
Well, to you know that you talk about songs that was a song that. Our dad, as mom said, was a baby child of 17 children, Pentecostal preachers, his family were. And growing up, you know, we had our Jewish grandparents, and then we had our Kentucky grandparents that were believers. And every time we would go visit our grandparents, they prayed three times a day, and I'm not talking about over dinner. When they called for dinner to come in, they would literally go in the living room, and they may pray 10 minutes or they may pray 30 minutes before they went to the table and bless the food. That was just, if it was good enough for Daniel, it was good enough for them. But my fondest memory of them is singing this song together. And you know, they died in 83 and 86, and I'm old enough to remember watching them and hearing them sing, mm-hmm. and just seeing the presence of God over this song. Is the song that you're talking about it's called "Is Not This the Land of Beulah," and it's probably 200 years old.
William Bradbury, right?
And it's to me that song, as I've gotten older, has become more relevant. You know, as a kid, I used to think, it's a cool song, you know. But as you get older, you start identifying more with what is the land of Beulah to me, because you know I'm over half of my life already, you know. So you don't think about life like that. So that to me, that song is probably the one that goes. That's the sleeper on there to me. That's the one that just speaks to me.
I think about. You know, the history of y'all's music, and I think about the Isaacs music, and I think of it as a soundtrack for people who love to follow Jesus.
Mm. Well, thank you.
Thank you. I love that song, too.
I would just say Grandma and Grandpa's song.
Yeah.
Our Grandpa would get so excited, he would be like at least a sentence ahead of Grandma.
She follow. She do harmony, but she follows.
Sing something with us.
Oh, my gosh.
Sing something.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roam, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is. It is well with my soul. It is well.
It is well
with my soul.
With my soul, it is well. It is well with my soul.
With my soul.
With my soul.